Mackay, good morning and welcome everyone to the sixth meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee in 2017. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets might be used by some members during the meeting. So as always, that's our plea, that's what we're doing. If you see on our computer during the meeting this morning, I promise. We have a full house, no apologies have been received. I'll be moved straight to agenda item one, which is decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to agree to consider its draft report on the draft climate change plan RPP3 in private at future meetings. Are we all agreed? Okay, I thank members for that. I will move to agenda item two under the heading of subordinate legislation, and the committee will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution on non-domestic rates, Scotland Order 2017. This item has been tabled by Andy Wightman. It was tabled a motion to annul this negative instrument, which will be formally considered at agenda item three, the next item on the agenda. So can I now move to welcome Derek Mackay, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution. Good morning, Mr. Mackay, and can I also thank Graham Owenson, Team Leader, Local Government Finance, Local Taxation Policy and Business Rates Unit, and Douglas McLaren, Head of Local Taxation, Local Government Finance, Local Taxation Policy and Business Rates Unit, Scottish Government, both of you this morning for coming along. Thank you, good morning. And I understand the Cabinet Secretary has some opening remarks to make.
Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to discuss with the committee Mr. Wightman's motion to annul the non-domestic rates Scotland Order 2017. This is a very simple instrument which is required annually to set the non-domestic rate, or the poundage, for the coming financial year. For 2017-18, this instrument will set the poundage at 46.6 pence, which is a reduction of 3.7% compared to the rate of 48.4 pence that applies in 2016-17. Although a simple instrument, the implications of it not coming into force would have a profound impact on our budget, which is due to complete its final parliamentary stages in stage three of the budget bill debate tomorrow. And in particular, it wouldn't support the resource to be provided to local government if not approved. We should all be absolutely clear that a decision to annul this instrument would leave a hole of more than £2.6 billion in our public spending, and specifically in the funding that goes to local government. I wish to maintain a competitive rates regime and have engaged directly with business and retail groups that have responded to their concerns, which is why the draft budget recognises the business rates revaluation and proposes a competitive package of measures to reduce rates across Scotland by £155 million. This is giving small and medium enterprises the security and confidence to grow in tough economic times. Next year, across Scotland, more than half of premises will pay no rates. 70% will pay either no rates or less rates than they do now, and the total package of reliefs we're offering will increase to more than £600 million. Additionally, this year we've increased the threshold for the large business supplement, meaning that 8,000 fewer premises will pay it, and as members will all be aware, we've increased the small business bonus threshold to ensure that 100,000 properties will no longer pay business rates. And as I announced to Parliament yesterday, in light of the revaluation of non-domestic premises, we will also ensure that across Scotland, no restaurant, pub, hotel or cafe will see their bills increased by more than 12.5% on April the 1st. Additional support is also injected into the northeast economy to recognise the impact of the oil and gas downturn, and we're supporting our renewables sector with a further package. So the estimated cost of the additional support package announced yesterday is £44.6 million, taking the total package of support to businesses in 2017-18 through the rates relief. It's now worth more than £668 million. I know that Mr. Wightman is looking for further debate on the matter of non-domestic rates, and I would suggest that the time to do that strategically is following the external review led by Ken Barclay, and that review is due to conclude this summer. So, Convener, in light of all of those comments and my undertaking to engage fully in further discussions on the wider scrutiny of the non-domestic rates process, I hope that Mr. Wightman can agree to withdraw his motion.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and we will move to questions, and I'll take Andy Wightman first.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In the explanatory notes to the non-domestic rates Scotland order, under background, you say that the 2017-18 business rate multiplier for England was set at 46.6 pence, and this instrument result in the poundage rate in Scotland being 46.6 pence. In other words, the only explanation we've got as to the poundage is that it's the same as England. Now, I'm well aware that in the last Parliament, the SNP had a manifesto commitment to maintain parity with the English rate for the duration of the last Parliament, but made no such commitment in this term. Yesterday in Parliament, you said that back in December, you had announced a range of actions the government will take from April, and you said that to reduce the impact of bills overall, I confirmed plans to reduce the poundage. So in a sense, it seems explicitly you chose this rate in order to reduce the impact of bills. In the explanatory notes, it appears it's to bring it into line with England. Can you explain something about the background and the criteria you use to decide what the poundage should be in any financial year?
Okay, essentially it does both. It does match the poundage to the case in England, so that's correct. It's also correct to say that the government had a manifesto commitment to do that in the past. It didn't feature in the 2016 manifesto in which we were elected to match the poundage with England. But we still believe that it puts us in a strong competitive position so to do. I also didn't insist on a revenue neutral revaluation. The range of actions that I've been able to take, as I say, will actually mean the same or less bills for 70% of companies and all the other key points that I've outlined to the committee and to the chamber yesterday. But by reducing the poundage, that is a reduction in the tax rate through non-domestic rates, but for the general poundage, it is matched to England. So the kind of considerations that any finance secretary would take into account when determining that is the overall budget position, the support for local government, and the right balance of measures to support business, which includes setting the poundage and then the other reliefs that the government's decided to take.
So in other words, the desire to reduce the impact of bills overall and the desire to maintain parity with England are just coincidentally bring you to the same number?
Well, both have been achieved.
No, I understand that. But I mean, you said in your answer to that, my previous question, that you did not insist on a revenue neutral revaluation?
Well, that's right, yeah.
Could you amplify what you mean by that and what were your other choices?
Well, the government obviously looks at the range of reliefs that we have, what support we want to give to businesses, that comes at a cost. So if you look at the decisions we've taken on the poundage to reduce the poundage, because the rateable value will be different in England, actually their rateable values have gone up higher than was the case in Scotland in terms of overall values. But the decisions we've taken around poundage, small business bonus and large business supplement, that's £155 million worth of reliefs or change to the poundage. So what we have done is we've determined what's right for our budget as set out through the draft budget beyond, whilst also matching the poundage, but I would argue being more generous around reliefs. So we've taken the decision in the context of the wider budget, the business environment, and what's happened south of the border as well. So in principle, we're matching the poundage in England, but we've taken decisions that, yes, have amounted to, you know, government ensuring that our resources are used to make sure there's a competitive environment for Scottish business, and that's why we've arrived at the decisions that we have.
So back in December, when you published the draft budget and you first indicated that the new rate would be 46.6 pence, at that stage, you were fully cited on the possible new tax base as a result of the revaluation?
We would have had some preliminary evidence at that point, by no means all the detail, because that's emerged over the last few months to take us to the position where we have more information what revaluation means now. And indeed, some of that will continue to change as businesses take, if they have reason to appeal, they might take appeals to panels as well. So those figures can still be fluid, but as time goes on, you have more certainty as to the estimates, the forecasts, and then the decisions that we can take. And that's why I think by draft budget in December, 15th of December, when I outlined the draft budget and also the local government settlement, it was important at that time to give certainty. And that was the early action, knowing some of the impacts from revaluation. But as I say, more has emerged over the last number of weeks.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for that. I have a number of other questions. I'll just ask one and then open it up to other members of the committee. Convener.
Mr. Wightman, on you go.
That's okay.
Yes.
So what consideration is given when you set the rate to regional variations across Scotland in land and property values? If, for example, values in one part of the country might be rising very, very fast, values in another part of the country might be rising, right, might be dropping very fast, for example, and you've just got one rate you can set.
Obviously, there's a wider debate to be had on whether we should have a nationally set rate or whether have locally set rates. Before Parliament was able to set it through the recommendation of government, I understand it was previously the Secretary of State that would have set the poundage in Scotland. So this is a far more democratic process coming through the Scottish Parliament. So when I have arrived at the decisions, of course I'll look at impact and forecasts and estimates. And of course I've described how the revaluation and the decisions that the government is able to take around poundage and all the reliefs being put into place will make a difference for people. And there is a difference from area to area, that is true. There's a difference in how the economy has performed, and not least in the northeast, which is why I've taken specific measures around the northeast and the relief and the supports there. It's also why when I was local government minister, when I was taking forward the community empowerment legislation through the bill, that we gave empowerment and enablement to local authorities to create local rates relief schemes that are right for them as well, to show that sense of empowerment, to help design a system that can adapt to local circumstances. But in terms of the poundage, the national rate is set by government, by Parliament, and then, as I say, there's room for flexibility around that and reliefs at a local level. But it's a nationally set rate where I take into account the national budget position, of course, the business environment we're trying to create, and then the reliefs that can be designed as appropriate.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms. White, for that line of questioning. We'll now take Graeme Simpson.
Thanks, Convener. So was your starting point in all this that you would match whatever the poundage was in England?
Well, I think the starting point is to look at all the information and evidence that we have, both in terms of the budget and the principles that we would want to pursue. And I think generally having a good competitive regime for business rates is absolutely worth pursuing. So whilst not a 2016 manifesto commitment, yes, I would like to maintain and match the poundage with England. However, there are now a range of things, and there have been a range of things that the government has done to make Scotland more competitive, particularly for small businesses. But yes, that's something that I generally support, but I have to look at the total budget position, the forecasts of income, what that means for local government, and take all of that in the round to answer that question fairly, Mr. Simpson. It is important, but it's one of many factors that any finance secretary would have to take into account when determining the rate.
Yeah, I get all that. It's just really around the poundage. So you seem to be saying that you were keen to match the English poundage in order to make Scottish businesses competitive. Is that correct?
Yes, I'm keen to do that, as I say, but there are many other factors that come into play when you're determining the budget. But yes, in principle, that's something that I have pursued.
Okay. If you were to not change the poundage, not reduce the poundage, what effect would that have you done any work on what effect that would have on Scottish businesses?
I think if it's self-evident, if I hadn't reduced the poundage, businesses would be paying more. The decision
Correct.
I've taken comes at a cost of £108 million in terms of the revaluation to reduce the poundage.
So, have we got a figure on what that would mean for Scottish businesses?
Sorry, the reduction's 3.7%.
Yeah. No, in terms, what would the cost be to Scottish businesses if we didn't reduce the poundage?
£108 million.
£108 million.
Yes. Okay. That's the figure that I have reduced the poundage by. £108 million
right.
that
Thank
businesses,
you.
As a consequence, don't need to pay. And that would be every business who pays business rates in the country. Their poundage is reduced as a consequence of this statutory instrument.
Right. Thank you. So clearly, if we were to agree with Mr. Wightman and not yourself, that has a major impact on Scottish businesses.
Well, first of all, if the statutory instrument wasn't agreed. Actually, the biggest loser would be public services, because I wouldn't be in a position to raise that tax to invest in public services. If we then had an argument over the rate, been right or wrong, that's almost a separate debate. But what the instrument does is that technical instrument to raise the revenue, to invest in our public services. But the rate at which I have set it is reduced.
Okay, I think that's very clear. If I could just make a point, and it's to agree with you earlier, that if we were to go down Mr. Wightman's route, we actually ought to be waiting for the Barclay review. If we want to look at how we reform things, that would be the way to proceed. Would you agree with that?
I have said I'm quite open-minded on further debate and discussion, and I think that the Barclay review will be very helpful around the subject of business rates. And yes, I'm happy to engage further on a cross-party basis and continue to engage with business, as I have been, to study this further.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure you're aware that this committee is also going to be taking some evidence in relation to non-domestic rates, and we've asked Ken Barclay himself to come to the committee, or someone from his team, to give us information ahead of publishing that review. So we'll be doing a piece of work on that. There's a feeling that non-domestic rates has perhaps never had so much scrutiny within the Scottish Parliament, but I think that's a good thing. So I think I would ask that, following the publishing of the Barclay review, would you come to this committee and give evidence to this committee in short order as well? I know you have to consider that review, but I think we would be quite keen to get you back to the committee to get your initial thoughts on it.
Convener, of course, I'm happy to engage with the committee in further discussion and further evidence. Absolutely happy to do that. In any event, I don't think it's the minister's gift to refuse to attend committee in any case, but of course I'd happily proactively do that. Not necessarily the same proactivity that you enjoy from UK government ministers, but I'd be happy to engage with the committee.
I wouldn't dream of making that political point, Cabinet Secretary. We'd always politely ask Cabinet Secretaries to come before we go down the road of insisting, so I appreciate that. I was writing down some notes in your opening statement. The specific financial cost to public services, the revenue we would forego if this motion was annulled today, can we just get that again for the public record? Because I think that weighs heavily in every member at this committee today.
Okay. It's £2.6 billion.
Yeah.
And
by and large, that is money that will go into the pockets of local authorities across Scotland?
Yes, entirely. The non-domestic rates is kept within the local authority area, same as council tax. The difference with non-domestic rates is multi-year budgeting, but yes, it all goes to local government.
I suspect if this motion is moved to annul, that number of £2.6 billion foregone by local authorities will be repeated by several members of this committee as a very negative thing and a very dangerous thing indeed. I've no further questions in relation to this. Elaine Smith.
Thanks. Thanks for joining us, Cabinet Secretary, this morning. I do want to ask about the process in line with what the convener's just been asking. But first of all, you mentioned in your opening statement the cap, basically the announcements that you made yesterday. So we have a cap for certain businesses, hotels, etc., but also a further advantage, if you like, for the northeast to offset the oil and gas situation. Could you tell me a bit more about that, how that would impact on businesses?
Okay, so the national action that I had taken from draft budget includes small business bonus, large business supplement, lowering the poundage. So that was the early actions I was able to take. But then understanding the impacts of the independent re-evaluation, of course, companies can still appeal if they think there is information to challenge the assessments from the assessors. So there is still the appeals process. The extra action was around where there's a sensitivity, I suppose, for the hospitality sector. There's two reasons for that. First of all, there's been the highest increases seem to be amongst the hospitality sector. The second big issue is that the methodology used has been around turnover. And when you take turnover into account, not necessarily profitability, but turnover at a point in time, it certainly gives the hospitality sector a justifiable case to look at that sector. So that is specifically hotels, pubs, cafes, and restaurants within that category. So that's hospitality, and that's why the cap of 12.5% within state aid rules felt appropriate. For the northeast of the country, the economy specifically there has been impacted because of the downturn in the North Sea. And so hospitality will have been an issue there and nationwide. But for the northeast, Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, it has been the case that, for example, offices have been impacted and rental values and so on. So again, a regional approach for that area is the appropriate thing to do when you look at the evidence and the circumstances and the exceptional case that they've been able to make. At the same time as those national reliefs and nationally targeted reliefs, I've also been working with local authorities. And the local authorities are important here because they have that empowerment. They have that locally enabled power to create any local rates relief scheme that's appropriate to them. Perth and Kinross Council is actually a trailblazer here, and they targeted support towards retail. Now, any council could have done that using their own resources. It's very flexible legislation, very empowering legislation. But Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire Council, first of all, Aberdeenshire Council had agreed, the administration had agreed a relief package around business rates. What they can now do is shape a local package of reliefs around what the government, the Scottish Government, is proposing to do. That might be to augment schemes, cover other sectors, whatever they choose to do, they can take that forward. And similarly, Aberdeen City Council will have a local rates relief package as well. And I understand Perth and Kinross are looking at, again, how to augment their scheme. Any other local authority in the country can help design further local reliefs that suit local circumstances, and I think that that should absolutely be encouraged and is the right thing to do to address any outstanding local issues. And I recognise that in any revaluation there'll still be hard cases, and that's why there should be existing flexibility for local authorities to look at that. So that's why I've done national scheme around hospitality, targeted to the northeast for that very specific reason, and then local authorities are empowered to look at further support.
Thanks, Convener. You know, I think that maybe brings us back to something Andy Wightman mentioned at the beginning about local circumstances. Perhaps that's something that's better looked at through the review, and I'm sure the committee will be looking at some of that when we take evidence as well. But can I just pin it down slightly more? Because certainly reading some of the stories of businesses and what they were going to face for sort of small and medium enterprises, local publicans, etc., little cafes, you could understand this. But I suppose what I want to specifically ask is, you mentioned hotels, so does that then include sort of big chain hotels? And I give an example because it springs to my mind that so President Trump, for example, has premises like that in the northeast. Does that mean that that hotel premises would benefit twice from a cap and then from relief in the northeast?
Well, first of all, as Elaine Smith would fully expect me to say, I can't design a tax policy to suit individual owners or indeed affect individual owners just based on their ownership. I can't and shouldn't design a tax system to target individuals. It has to be about fairness and sectors and then indeed geographies. The scheme that I've described for hospitality benefits the whole country, of course, right across the whole country. As I say, 70% of people will enjoy no rates or reduced rates as a consequence of our actions. I can't itemise individual owners. I don't think the member seriously would expect me to do that, bring everyone's rateable values to committee with me. But what I can say is that our relief scheme has been designed in light of the evidence that's been presented to me by the sector and warmly welcomed by the sector's business representatives, who I'll see later today as well. In terms of the cap, though, the cap at 12.5%, I mean, half of all hotels, small hotels, would have been paying no business rates anyway because of the small business bonus. So we have targeted our support to smaller and medium-sized companies, but for the larger hotels the member is identifying, state aid rules would comply. And state aid rules mean that support can only be given to a certain amount. That works out at £170,000 over a three-year period. Yes, some of that support might be consumed in the first year, but that cap of support does apply. So there's only so much support any individual company can get. but the balance feels right to target our support to small and medium-sized enterprises. But for many of the hotels, it had put across a legitimate case about what it might mean for their business. And, you know, I did hear examples of how even the big hotels, you know, may have been threatened by a huge increase. I think that is why it's right to have a balanced approach that provides as much of a competitive regime as possible and relief for as many as possible right across the country, and every council area receives support from this, but in a fair and a proportionate way.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just briefly turn to the process then now as well? Although, first of all, just clarifying that keeping it the same as England with the reduction that we're talking about, that is then basically a loss to the public services that you say would lose out if we don't pass, you know, if we annulled this instrument today, then there would be a loss to public services. But the fact that it's been kept the same as England and it's not being raised, is that also a loss? Well, I take the opposite view from, I'm asking the opposite question to Graeme Simpson,
well,
I suppose.
There is a point of view that if we didn't lower the poundage and we raise more money from businesses, if we tax more, we can invest more money in public services. That is a point of view. I've taken the view, and I hope that committee agrees with me, that this is the right balance. We're matching the poundage in England. It does represent a reduction to the tax rate for businesses in terms of the poundage. Still raises an adequate amount of money, applies all the reliefs that I've described that support, you know, 100,000 businesses through small business bonus and all the other support measures that I've outlined, the regional support, the capping. I think it's a very comprehensive package and I think it's the right one. However, public services are still adequately funded because, of course, government's using other resources, other tax decisions and other measures to ensure that we invest in our public services and in our local services. And on the 15th of December, I published the local government settlement as well as the circular. And since then, of course, as a consequence of the budget negotiations with the Greens, credit where it's due, I've allowed a decision for further resources to go to local government. So there's huge investment in local services representing an increase, as well as the council tax changes we've made as well. So that does all represent you know, a substantial increase for our local services of well over £300 million, as well as an appropriate tax decision as well.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We've had that debate. You know, I'm not going to obviously go down that road this morning again, you know, as a point of view, if you like, about whether or not it's increases or not to local government. No, however, well, what is a fact, obviously, is that rather than a point of view, would be that if you didn't decrease the poundage, then there would be more funding available. But however, it is a point of view whether or not you wish to do that. So perhaps I could just move on to the process of this whole instrument today. You've said that if this instrument were to be annulled today, then that clearly means that, what was the figure again? 2.6 to local government would be lost. However,
just point out for procedure that if we're asking a question about what the figure should be, we shouldn't answer it. We should leave that to the Cabinet Secretary.
I've given you it three times.
So just for clarity, I think our Deputy Convener was asking what the figure for the loss to public services might be if this was annulled today.
Okay, and what I would then like to ask is, if it was annulled today, would it be the case that would just simply be lost, or would there be processes put in place? What would happen to the budget process? Clearly, it's not an option just not to take this forward in some way. So what is the actual process? Let's suppose that it is, because we don't know what's going to happen under item 3 at the moment of the agenda. So let's suppose that the committee is minded to annul the instrument. What then would be the process?
Well, Convener, if I can say, I don't think this committee would be that reckless to risk over £2.6 billion to the public services of Scotland. I don't believe that any member of this committee would actually let that happen. You know, either the government could bring forward a new statutory instrument, or it could go to the full chamber of Parliament. But I know the members of this committee are reasonable and sensible people and wouldn't jeopardise over £2.6 billion worth of public services. And, well, in terms of process...
I sorry to interject, but I feel as if we're drifting into a debate, which is at agenda item 3. So if we could have questions, and I apologise for stifling that debate, but if we could have questions and answers, that would be quite helpful.
Well, before we do, because we have discussed the money that would be lost to local government already under this item, and because we have discussed the motion to annul and what would be the consequences of that, yourself, Convener, pointed out that the consequences of that, what I need to know is what the process is. So if there was an agreement to annul, whether or not members round the table would decide to go down that route is conjecture at the moment, and whether or not members are sensible or not is also conjecture. What I would like to know is the facts of whether... I would like to know the facts of what happens if the committee were... Because we've had the motion, so someone has put the motion forward. We do have the motion on the table. What would be the consequences? What would be the timetable? This is the only opportunity I'm going to get to ask that, because if we move into the next item, it then becomes a debate with no questions. So I would like to clarify what the timetable would be if this motion to annul were to be. When would it go to the chamber? When would another motion come forward from the government? What would be the timetable?
Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, in fairness to me, you're asking me questions that are actually appropriate to parliamentary business, because what would happen next is it would go to Parliament, and that would be for parliamentary business managers, I imagine, to determine. Of course, ideally, I would like it to happen before stage three of the budget, because I don't think that it would be appropriate to proceed with the budget without that certainty that the non-domestic rates income would be received. I would also want to point out that this process is not a new one. This is the same annual process for how we set non-domestic rates. There is no change here. And I outlined the government's position in the poundage. That's what this statutory instrument is about. Everything else is peripheral to that. The key issue here is the poundage. That's what we're setting through the statutory instrument. If that's approved, the over £2.6 billion can be raised and therefore distributed to local government as set out in the government draft budget and circular. If it wasn't approved, then it would go to the full chamber for a full chamber vote in the timescale that Parliament determined. So that's the process issue. The process hasn't changed. The poundage will be set by Parliament, and then people will have the certainty to get on with it. I want to make one further point about scrutiny, though. It would be wrong to say that business rates has had no scrutiny. Since the 15th of December, when I outlined the draft budget, I covered rates issues in the draft budget. On the very same day, I sent the local government settlement out and also the circular. So from that point, there has been awareness and engagement in the business rates and the local government settlement issue. Yes, augmented by the budget negotiation process, but there has been many opportunities to engage in that. Stage one debate, stage two debate, appearance at committees, and of course there'll be a further opportunity at stage three debate and any further statutory instrument that may be required for further release, all subject to those established parliamentary processes. So that's the process, Convener. I hope that helps, but timescales in the hands of parliamentary business. But I say again, realistically, I don't think that this committee would really put at risk the £2.6 billion worth of non-domestic rates to support our local services.
Anything additional on that from our Vice Governor, Cabinet Secretary, could be left the debate in Agenda Item 3, perhaps. Is it okay if we perhaps move on to Alexander Stewart for a further line of questioning?
Thank you, Camilla. Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much for outlining where you are and why you made the decisions you did with reference to some of the reliefs to the industries and to locations. For those who are not in that category, obviously you've talked about an appeal process and there's an appeal panel that can take place. Is it anticipated that the majority of people who find themselves now in excess of the rates they had in the past will go for an appeal? Obviously these appeal panels will take time to progress and process and decisions to be made. And have you factored into anything in your process how that will take place? Because there could be thousands of businesses who feel aggrieved in this process and want to appeal and have to go through that process. And therefore, there's a knock-on effect as to what will happen with their rates and if they do manage to get an appeal or it is carried on as was expected. And have you factored that into the process?
Mr. Stewart asks a very good question and also recognises that both the revaluation process and the appeals is independent of government. So I can't direct... But we, of course, would factor in appeals assumptions as part of our budgeting process. So I can't predict how many would appeal, but experience would tell us that most probably do appeal. Indeed, there is. If you take some of the sectors, you know, there's some evidence from some businesses that they withhold information and then present appeal, and that then means that there's a different outcome on what their rateable value is, and therefore what they pay. So that has been the experience of the past. Most appeal will have to work through the system, and I see no reason why that wouldn't be the case this time round.
And my second question goes back to the local government, and you commented on Perth and Carnoss, my own Sound Council, about what they had achieved in trying to support local schemes. Are you, as a Cabinet Secretary, disappointed that other local authorities have not gone down that route? Or are you surprised? Or was that expected?
I don't want to criticise local authorities. I think I've taken appropriate action at draft budget and since on this issue as information has emerged. But I do welcome the fact that Perth and Kinross took action using the powers. They were the first council to use these powers previously. And Aberdeenshire, in view of the revaluation, has moved quickly to produce a scheme and have engaged with Aberdeen City as well. I had a very constructive meeting with Grampian Chambers of Commerce where I met businesses and we discussed the way forward, and I said the range of actions that I've taken. And that Chamber of Commerce has welcomed the actions that I've taken. I've been true to my word on how I would engage and what I would do on business rates. Now, they also asked the council to take action, and I think they'll continue to lobby the council, Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, to provide a local rates relief scheme that's appropriate. But yes, I would encourage every single local authority of Scotland to look at the local circumstances and say what might be appropriate. And some councils might conclude that it's not appropriate, some others might conclude that it is appropriate. But there's legal empowerment so to do. I think there are extra resources in the system as a consequence of the budget negotiations, and local authorities should feel empowered to build in any augmentation or additional support that they feel is appropriate, and should engage with local business in arriving at that. But that is a matter for them. So that's encouragement from the government, and my officials will provide whatever support is necessary to do that, as we have done with Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire.
Thank you, Convener.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, to follow on from what Elaine Smith was asking, I mean, the implication was that the £108 million that you're putting into cutting the rate poundage is money lost to local authorities. But is it not the fact that if you don't maintain a competitive business rates, you could in fact lose some businesses and then you don't collect any money whatsoever from them? Because the Federation of Small Businesses said at the peak of the recession without the small business bonus scheme, one in six small businesses would have went bust. Therefore, you wouldn't have been collecting any rates. Therefore, there would have been money to go to local government. So a balance has to be struck.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Kenneth Gibson raises a fair point. I mean, what Elaine Smith, I suppose, was saying, is if I had taken another decision and put business rates up far higher, that would have generated more income, in theory, for the public sector. But actually, the budget that I'm delivering already delivers £900 million more for the public sector and the public services of Scotland, including a substantial increase, of course, for local services as well. So I'm already doing that public sector investment bit, but what I'm not doing is trying to undermine business. So that's why I've set the business rates at that appropriate level. Now, Kenneth Gibson's also right to say that if they weren't set appropriately, yes, that could damage business, you know, and if there were inappropriate decisions around the tax rate or absence of reliefs, then yes, some businesses would of course be stressed from that. I know that Kenneth Gibson's a fond of Paisley, as I am. I actually launched the business rates policy in Paisley. The business I had visited was one of many who, for the first time, will be applicable to enjoy a small business bonus. What they're going to do with that resources help employ new staff, grow the business. So I think it's shown how the small business bonus is specifically supporting businesses and help them grow and help sustain our high streets at this very difficult time. So I think we've got the balance right whilst not jeopardising the income.
Just on another point, I was going to ask completely unrelated to the issue we've just discussed. Rural rate relief, about £5 million a year, so it's less than 1% of the total support that the Scottish Government provides to business in terms of rates relief. I'm just wondering how it ties in with the small business bonus, given the threshold of 8,500 compared to the 15,000, you know, under which small business bonus means that no rates are paid. So where does it actually fit into the big picture now? I mean, because obviously rural Scotland is a lot bigger than the 5 million relief would suggest. So it seems to be a fairly small beer in relation to other reliefs that the Scottish Government implements.
Convener, it's a good question. A lot of our national reliefs, like small business bonus, clearly will help a lot of rural businesses as well. So that catches a lot of the rural businesses, and that's concentrated in certain areas. So I suppose that the rural rates relief is a further safeguard, a further catch-all to try and support businesses that might not benefit from the other rates reliefs, which are of course supportive of urban and rural. Dougie McLaren can give a bit more detail on how the additional rural relief does that.
So the small business bonus scheme does have the higher eligibility threshold of the 15,000 rateable value, but as you might be aware, If an occupier has multiple premises, that the cumulative rateable value can take them over that threshold. So what the rural relief does is it catches premise, irrespective of that, it catches premises up to an individual rateable value of X for store, pub, hotel, restaurant, filling station. Except there's a case for adjusting that. It's been the same rateable value threshold for a number of years, but because so many of these properties are caught by the small business bonus, in practice there's actually very few that rely on that kind of extra safety net of the rural relief.
I thought because of the amount of money, actually, it was I mean, one of the concerns about the system, and obviously the Bartley Review will be looking at this, is the complexity, and I was wondering if there's still, I mean obviously the recipients of that will still obviously take the view that it has a role to play, but I'm just wondering if it can be done in a more efficient, effective way, given the huge support that's gone into the small business bonus scheme relative to that.
I think administratively, yes. I mean, I won't dwell too much, but some of the reliefs they actually have in the legislation, a hierarchy, so councils have to apply one before the other. But in case of small business bonus and rural relief, the council just makes sure that the business gets the best benefit across the two reliefs. But I accept there's a case for a bit of streamlining administratively.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any further questions from members before we give the Cabinet Secretary the opportunity to make some closing remarks and move to the next agenda item? Okay. Can I just ask one very brief question, Cabinet Secretary? Politicians and politicians, politics come into play quite often in relation to things such as this, but should we in the future look at the next time non-domestic rates are looking at any changes or revaluations or whatever, should we look at this kind of dynamic as a normal part of the political process? Is it not reasonable for governments to get data, hypothesise what a rates poundage might look like, what a rates relief scheme might look like, and then take the temperature out in wider Scotland and make amendments as appropriate? Should we not just see this as part of the normal process in the future and embrace it rather than get into where I think we've got to as a parliament, where it's been adversarial?
Well, convener, in that ideal world, that sounds good to me, where it's not adversarial and everybody's happy at the outset. If you can help me design a process that achieves that, I'm happy to engage. But can I say in all seriousness that in answer to Andy Whiteman's question in the Chamber just yesterday, I did say that the Budget Review Group, which is looking at how the Parliament delivers its tax powers and its budget powers, I think it is worthy of further consideration. But as I say, the process that we have inherited, the process that we've traditionally used, is the one that is being used for setting the non-domestic rates. But as I say, we're happy to engage in this issue through the Budget Review Group, which has experts here as well. But I would make the point again that, you know, revaluation is independent of government. It's a really important point. It's independent of government. And as we get the evidence, and as businesses and their representatives get the evidence, we respond. So I took early actions in the draft budget, as I've described, and then I've taken further actions as the evidence has emerged. So Parliament has had the opportunity to discuss this at the stages I've described, stage one, issuing of the local government settlement, stage two. We'll also have the time to debate it further, if that's what people want to do, at stage three. Committee appearances and in other places. So I think it has had a good airing Is there a better way to do it? Well, let's engage with that discussion.
I suppose it wasn't a naivety in asking the question, Cabinet Secretary. Politics always comes into things, but it should be a normalisation of this process. From what I can see, it's reasonable for the independent assessors to do their job. It's reasonable for the government to make a first cut of what a rates relief scheme might look like, and it's reasonable for businesses in Scotland to take some views on that. This is an entirely normal part of the process, and it's reasonable to expect a Cabinet Secretary to then react and act appropriately based on those concerns. Should we not find a better way of normalising this process?
Well, as I say, Convener, I'm happy to engage if you think there's another way or a better way of doing it. But what I would want to reassure the committee is that when government gets the evidence, we consider it. Government then presents their proposals. Other opposition parties can present alternative proposals if they want, if they think we've got the wrong poundage or the wrong balance of reliefs or the wrong budget decisions. That can happen in this Parliament. That is normal. Then there's the budget negotiations as well. If Parliament doesn't like the package that this government has put across, they can vote against it, and they could have suggested alternatives. What will be really interesting is, after the government has engaged with the business community, has looked at the evidence, has delivered a budget that invests in our public services to the tune of over £900 million, has set tax rates that are fair and balanced, that any opposition party would dare vote against all those very progressive, proactive and pro-enterprise measures? That would be the interesting question, Convener.
We'll move to the debate, Cabinet Secretary, which really wasn't my intention there. Your point's on the record. Mr. Wightman, did you want back in? Right. OK, now, that may have been your closing statement, Cabinet Secretary.
It was, Convener.
Right. OK, well, in that case, can I thank you for taking part in the evidence session. It was fairly robust, and it was a longer evidence session than we'd anticipated, but I didn't want to stifle debate in such an important matter, and thank our officials as well for being in attendance. We now move to agenda item 3, and the committee will now consider motion number S5M03997 in the name of Andy Wightman, asking the Local Government Communities Committee to recommend that the non-domestic rate Scotland Order 2017 be annulled. To set out the procedure, Andy Wightman will first speak to and move the motion. There's an opportunity for members to debate the motion and Cabinet Secretary to respond for up to 90 minutes. Can I put on the record here, I will not be devastated if it doesn't take 90 minutes. Can I say to the MSPs here and the Cabinet Secretary, of course. Following that debate, Andy Wightman will be invited to wind up the debate, and finally, Andy Wightman will be asked whether he wishes to press or withdraw his motion. So at this point, can I invite Andy Wightman to speak to and to move the motion S5M03997.
Thank you, Convener. Can I first of all clarify why I've tabled this motion to annul the non-domestic rate order? Since 1989, the tax rate, the poundage, has been set by central government under secondary legislation. Prior to 1989, prior to the Conservatives centralising this local tax, it was set by individual local authorities. And since this secondary legislation is considered using the negative procedure, the only means of scrutinising the decision of ministers as to the rate is by means of a motion to annul the relevant statutory instrument. So thus, to achieve a modest degree of scrutiny, I've tabled this motion. It is not, and it never has been, my intention to deny local government these important resources. And I should also add, Convener, that I took the decision to do this before the recent publicity of our revaluations, and my intention here is solely to provide the opportunity for some scrutiny and not as a Trojan horse for any wider political goals of other parties. Now, I had originally intended to table a motion to annul Instrument 2017/9, introducing the small business bonus scheme as well, but decided to take things one at a time. But let me illustrate why that, for example, would also benefit from greater scrutiny. I'm engaged with constituents in Edinburgh at the moment to reform the planning regime around short-term lets due to concerns about residential amenity and the accelerating clearance of the residential population in central Edinburgh. And I mention this because these holiday let properties that do declare themselves liable for non-domestic rates, and not all do, and that I've looked at so far, are eligible for 100% rates relief, despite having tens of thousands in turnover, properties owned by owners often outside Scotland. And because of the instrument that we will pass at another agenda item, pay absolutely nothing to Edinburgh City Council to contribute to the cost of maintaining the city that provides their income. Instead, this Parliament subsidises these, in my view, undeserving proprietors by compensating councils with public funds. So this is just one example where, in my view, the Scottish Small Business Bonus Scheme is flawed, but notwithstanding the merits of any criticism of that, there is no easy means of scrutinising the detail of such policy arising from the non-domestic rate legislative regime. So I hope the Cabinet Secretary will agree that Parliament should be able to scrutinise relief schemes that involve the expenditure of hundreds of millions of pounds. I heard the Cabinet Secretary at the previous item talking about the opportunities at stage one, stage two, stage three of the budget. But with respect, those are debates. Those are not opportunities for detailed scrutiny, and it's scrutiny that I concerned about. Convener, I'm also aware that the Barclay Review is currently examining non-domestic rates. I expect Parliament obviously to debate its findings, but I want Parliament also to be given the opportunity for a much more fundamental examination of the non-domestic rating regime. There are much, much more fundamental questions of tax design to consider that go well beyond the Barclay Review terms of reference, and indeed bring into question the very existence of the non-domestic rating regime. One of the Scottish Government's own economic advisers, James Middleton, has already argued we should scrap the business rates system. And I would like to put on the record that the Barclay Review asks one question, and that question is, in the public consultation, how would you redesign the business rate system to better support business and incentivise investment? It says nothing about the degree of central control versus more local control. It says nothing, for example, about the range of exemptions that historically existed for things like agriculture. So these are important things that the Barclay Review will not be looking at, and why in this place we need to consider deeper questions about the future of the non-domestic rating regime. And finally, as I mentioned, the Barclay Review says nothing about local government per se, but nevertheless, non-domestic rates are an important part of local government finance, and in my view, should be part of any review, future review of local taxation. Now, I know that Cabinet Secretary is keen to talk with other parties about how we take forward further reforms on local taxation, and I look forward to those discussions, which can hopefully take place once the finance bill is safely on the statute book. But meantime, can he provide me with some assurance that he recognises that there is a case for better ongoing scrutiny of all the variety of secondary legislation that comes into Parliament, and we shouldn't have to do motions to annul just to get that scrutiny? And secondly, does he recognise there is also a case, whether he agrees with it or not, but there is a case for returning at least part of the rate setting and tax design to local authorities so that they can take decisions on their own tax base to suit circumstances in their different areas? Convener, I move the motion in my name.
Cabinet Secretary, don't answer those questions because it's a debate and you'll have the opportunity during that debate to respond to any of the points made. Do any other members wish to participate in the debate at this point? Yeah. Elaine Smith.
Although probably not for 90 minutes, but thank you very much, Convener. So I think there would probably be a better way to do these things, but for the committee, the only option to have this kind of discussion and debate was for a motion of annulment, and so that is what we have in front of us. I think it's disrespectful in a way to the committee to just assume that the committee are not going to press forward with this because of the loss of possible loss of revenue to local government. And the reason I say that is because I think that would then be an assumption that the Parliament wouldn't be willing to schedule a chamber debate in good time. And I also look back to what the Cabinet Secretary said previously, that it would be difficult for the budget to be debated on Thursday or to be voted on without this, but from what the Cabinet Secretary said, it would not be impossible. And I'm quite sure, I would have confidence that the Business Bureau would manage to get this to the chamber in time to have it debated and voted upon. And the reason that we might want to do that would be for further scrutiny. However, I do also accept what the Cabinet Secretary said about it being done this way as the normal way to do it. But what I would say is that doesn't mean that it's always the right way to do it. I think that some commitment to better scrutiny rather than just through a negative instrument and the only option being for some member of the committee to lay a motion to annul, I don't think that that's ideal at all. So I think that that has to be taken on board. But I do think it's rather dramatic to be talking about if we were to annul it then that would be a complete loss, because I do believe that part of the process would be that the business managers could manage to get this into the chamber for a debate and for scrutiny. However, given what's been said, given the points that have been made earlier, if Andy Wightman is going to withdraw, then personally, at this point, I wouldn't be inclined to argue with that. However, if he has decided to press it, then I may well be inclined to vote with that. But I think that for the future, undoubtedly, proposals in relation to this do need to have much greater scrutiny. I mean, we know that it's the second largest single source of revenue under the control of the Scottish Government, so it does seem wrong to me to just simply be disposing of it through secondary legislation and the negative procedure. I think there has to be rather more discussion and scrutiny, and like Andy Wightman, not just simply in budget debates around the chamber, because not all members can participate in those. We know that there's limited time for debates in the chamber, unlike the 90 minutes that we have this morning if we want to use it. So that would be the point I would make about it. I think the whole point is about scrutiny. I think it's been good that we've had a debate and discussion about it. Perhaps the committee could have delved a bit more into this in their own budget scrutiny, and maybe that's something that we need to think about for the future as well. So I think it's been a positive engagement this morning, and I will await to see what Mr. Wightman sums up and decides. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, Mr. Simpson.
thanks, Convener. I won't speak for very long. I do take Andy Wightman's point about scrutiny in general. I think he's right, there isn't enough. And it is a shame he's felt as he has that he has to go down this route in order to get some level of scrutiny. But if we're going to cut to the chase, what's before us is an issue around poundage, pure and simple. So I can't sit here and vote to annul, knowing that that would cost Scottish businesses £108 million. I think that would be irresponsible, frankly. There is also, of course, the threat, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, to local government finances, so we have to be aware of that. I think, as I said earlier, the right process to follow is to wait for the results of the Barclay review. We know it's going on. That will come before this committee. There'll be a great deal of scrutiny, I hope, around that, and that is the opportunity for people like Andy Wightman and all the members of this committee to have their say on a future system of business rates. So on that basis, if Andy wishes to proceed, I'm afraid I won't be voting with him on this occasion.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. Mr. Gibson, you wanted in?
Yeah, thanks very much. Actually, a lot of it's just to follow on from what Graham has actually said there. I don't think local government really thank us, actually, at a time when a lot of them are setting their budgets for, throwing a spanner in the works here. I know businesses certainly won't thank us for the potential loss of £108 million. So I will not be supporting the budget. The issue of scrutiny is an important one. But I think ultimately what we don't want to do is kill the goose that lays the golden eggs, which are our businesses who are relying a lot on some of the reductions in poundage and other reliefs which the Cabinet Secretary is introducing. And therefore, I do not think that we should support the motion to annul.
Okay, thank you. Ruth McGuire, do you want to add?
Yeah. Convener, just briefly, I recognise that there is, you know, probably a wider debate to be had on rate setting, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments about that and on whether that should be, you know, national or regional setting. But to agree with colleagues that have already said, I think that we have to allow the external review process to move forward and explore how business rates can be kind of best reflect economic conditions and support growth. the big thing for me today, though, is, and I don't think it should be minimised, the profound impact that this would have on the budget setting process and that £2.6 billion hole in public spending.
Thank you very much. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I acknowledge where we are in this committee and the opportunity we have to discuss and debate, and I think it's right that we do have that opportunity in front of us today. But I have to also understand and take on board that we do have an external review, and I think that's right and proper that we have that opportunity for that to take its course. It should take its course. We can then be involved in that process once we have some actions that they want to recommend or some opportunities that they want to come forward. So I, like others today, firmly believe that we should be waiting to see what comes from the review at the end of summer, and at that stage, giving ourselves the opportunity to then put forward and agree or disagree with the review when it comes at that level. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I'm going to make a brief contribution myself, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, a defence of where we are just now, I suppose, could be it's always been done this way, but I think what Mr. Wightman was trying to say is going forward, it would be good to modernise and develop how we scrutinise non-domestic rates. I think it's also fair to put on the record before the political attention around this, the Scottish Government had already commissioned an independent review on non-domestic rates. So I think that has to be commended as well, and there's perhaps a meeting of minds within the Parliament in relation to modernising how we look at this process. In terms of my position as a committee chair, I was asking the clerks there, at what point could a motion to annul have been lodged in this place, given how close we are to the final budget on Thursday? The earliest we could have done a motion to annul was the 8th of February, is my understanding. So not that long. It would still have been quite a tight time scale to take it to the full chamber to have a debate and look at alternatives. And that was because of the pipeline coming from the Subordinate Legislation Committee. So perhaps even if there's no particular change to the current system, we have to think about timings of the process rather than changing the process itself. I know there's an independent review of the budgetary processes in this place as well, Cabinet Secretary. But that said, in terms of scrutiny, it's a fairly significant piece of scrutiny that we're doing today, I feel, as a committee. Had we done this a number of weeks ago, I think that might have been pretty good, I have to say. We did have the option to look at this in some detail during our budget process. We chose not to do that as a committee. That was our choice to do that. So we have to look at our working practices. It's not just a matter of saying what level of scrutiny does the government or does this parliament afford non-domestic rates. The committee system has to look at our role within that as well. I think it's only fair to put that on the record. And also, just to put on the record once again, that this committee is now going to do a piece of work on non-domestic rates. We're going to hear from the Barclay Review. We're going to get feedback from government after the Barclay Review has finally published, and there will be an ongoing piece of work. That sounds like a heck of a lot of scrutiny to myself. So in terms of scrutiny and process, I feel no reason to support any motion to annul. But I suppose even if I did and I don't, it's that figure of £2.6 billion to public services. Whether it's a potential risk or a direct threat kind of does not matter to myself. I would say to other MSPs, I don't think we can afford any uncertainty as councils across the country are setting their budget. It's social work departments, it's education departments in my city and in other MSPs' constituencies and regions. And for that reason, I certainly wouldn't be minded to annul today either. That's my final contribution in the debate. I want to give the opportunity for the Cabinet Secretary to respond to the comments made, and then finally for Mr. Wightman to come back in. Cabinet Secretary.
Hey, thank you, Convener. First of all, can I say I appreciate the comments that have been made and the discussion that we've had on it. Genuinely, I have not and do not object to the scrutiny. As you have said, Convener, I could have answered questions on this when I've appeared at this committee or Finance Committee or any other place in relation to the budget. The government published our budget proposals on the 15th of December, and from that point, any party or business or other interested stakeholder can engage with the government on our draft proposals, which are all subject to due parliamentary and political process concluding at stage three of the budget. And of course, there are further SIs, statutory instruments, where appropriate on any other relevant matter. And on a consensual point, I did yesterday agree that I was open to the budget review group, which is an agreement and working between government and parliament, and experts looking about how the Scottish Parliament's scrutiny and legislative process should adapt to the new powers that we have. And of course that can at the same time look at the existing powers that we have, of which non-domestic rates is one, very substantial one. Indeed, so I said I was already open to that and was very proactive around a budget review group engagement and how we adapt our parliamentary processes, made even more significant from the Chancellor's decision to change how they do their budget setting timetables to an autumn budget rather than a spring budget. Of course, this year we'll have two budgets. And members will also want to reflect on the fact that the Chancellor can, the UK Chancellor can propose a budget essentially in one day, and the scrutiny largely comes thereafter, where our processes does a lot of the scrutiny in advance of the budget being set. So we have to get the balance right, and I hope that covers some of the points around engagement on this issue and normalisation. I think it will be impossible to take the politics, as the convener has described it, out of it, in that tax is of course a very sensitive matter, but one that I would want to make decisions in a research-based, methodical and orderly fashion, and that's the approach that I've taken. And that is the question essentially before us. If this process is wrong now, why has it been wrong for years? Because it's the same process that's been used for years. Now, as I say, I'm open-minded to look at how we can improve it, but I think members who are new to the process, I'm a relatively new finance secretary, new members to Parliament, have put a fresh pair of eyes upon it, and I have no objection to that as part of our overall approach. Barclay Review has very specific remit, but self-defined remit with key purpose, but of course this can allow for further consideration. But it would have a local impact if these revenues weren't raised and then distributed. Now, a key point that members have raised, though, is about certainty. There's an administrative element to this now that, you know, councils need to get on with issuing the bills. If businesses want to appeal, that they can do that. But essentially, that there's certainty in the system to get on with it. So the question that's before us is actually just the poundage, not the other matters of great interest, but the poundage. And what I haven't heard since the day and hour that I published the government's position is any variance to that position on the poundage. The question before us is the poundage. I haven't heard any party say put it up, bring it down. The poundage seems to have got a general consensus and agreement. That's of course a reduced poundage of 3.7%, and for all the reasons I've given, that feels like the appropriate balance. So members need to reflect on that is the question before us, not the other matters, and it is that setting the poundage and raising the revenue to distribute that could be put at risk by not proceeding with this statutory instrument. You know, I don't want to be too negative because I've tried to be consensual and constructive, but I do find it a bit strange for some members to say, tell me what I'm voting against and what you're going to do to fix it, if we're actually as reckless to proceed along those lines. As I say, I've conducted myself in an orderly fashion, publishing the poundage from the 15th of December, and it does feel to an extent like, from some members' point of view, an 11th hour bid to look at it again, when in fact there seems to be no disagreement on the actual poundage that the government is proposing. So for all those reasons, I would suggest that we approve the statutory instrument and continue with the budget as it's been working its way through Parliament and being subjected to the appropriate scrutiny.
Okay, thank you for your contribution, Cabinet Secretary. And I move to Andy Wightman to respond to the debate that we've just participated within and to press or withdraw S5M 03997.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I've heard what the Cabinet Secretary said, and I just want to put on the record I have no criticism of any of the actions he's taken. The processes he's adopted, the processes that he has adopted have been strictly in line with the legislative requirements here. I have to be perfectly frank, I don't know whether the rate he's proposing is the best rate or the rate last year was the best rate. I'm not in a position to do that because I'm not availed of all the evidence and the analysis that the Cabinet Secretary has had last year to himself arrive at that at new rate. And so my motive has been solely to try and have a bit of scrutiny about how that poundage is set. What is the process? What are the considerations that come into play? And how does he arrive at the figure? Once that figure has arrived at, I may or may not agree. The second point that's been raised is the Barclay Review, and I just repeat the comments I made in my opening remarks. The Barclay Review has a limited remit. I do not actually agree. It's not the kind of remit I would have given a review of non-domestic rates. It does not look at some of the issues that I, for example, are interested in, and I hope we can return to some of those issues in Parliament in future. Also, to repeat my opening remarks, it never has been my intention to put these revenues at risk. But whilst the rate is set by a negative instrument, the only way of formally having any scrutiny on the legal instrument is a motion to annul. However, I realise this is very, very late in the day. Stage three of the finance bill is tomorrow. I've heard what the Cabinet Secretary has said on that. And in these circumstances, I withdraw my motion.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Wightman. We have to seek the approval of the committee. Are members content for Andy Wightman to seek to withdraw his motion? Okay, that is agreed. As the motion has been withdrawn, that concludes our consideration of agenda item 3. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for attending and your officials, of course. Thank you. We'll give a briefly suspend, actually, just until we our witnesses leave. Thank you. Okay, welcome back everyone. We're now moved to agenda item 4, which is still subordinate legislation. The committee will now consider two negative instruments as listed on the agenda, SSIs 2017/9 and 2017/22. These instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means that their provisions will come into force unless the Parliament votes on a motion to annul the instruments. No motions to annul have been laid, and can I invite members to make any comments that they may have on the instruments? Mr. Wightman.
Thank you, Convener. I do have quite a lot to say about the Non-Domestic Living Scotland Regulation 2017, SSI 2017/9, but I don't intend to say it, merely to draw committee's attention to comments I made in the previous item of the agenda, to comments made by the STUC as reflected in the Finance Committee's report on the draft budget. But given the limited opportunity for scrutiny, detailed scrutiny of the regulation, I will not go into the detail, but merely to note that I think there are issues there that need further proper scrutiny in future.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other comments? Okay, can I invite members whether the committee wishes to agree that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to either of these instruments? Okay, thank you very much. And we now move to agenda item 5. A little bit later than scheduled. The committee will now take evidence of the Scottish Government's draft climate change plan, RPP3, from the Minister for Local Government and Housing. And this follows two sessions held with key stakeholders at the past two meetings. So can I therefore welcome Kevin Stewart, Minister for Local Government and Housing. Welcome, Minister. And can I also welcome his officials that have joined them today, Stephen Garland, Head Sustainable Housing Unit, Better Homes Division, and Gareth Feeney, Policy Manager, Sustainable Housing Unit, Better Homes Division, Scottish Government. And can I ask the Minister whether he has any opening statements he wishes to make?
Yes, please, Convener, and thank you for inviting me here today to talk about the draft climate change plan, which sets the Scottish Government's policies and proposals for meeting Scotland's climate change targets. My portfolio includes responsibility for domestic energy efficiency in all tenures, local government planning, and of course standards for new buildings. Mr. Wheelhouse's portfolio leads on renewable and low carbon heat, but it's important to see energy efficiency and low carbon heat as a single package, and that is why we have brought this action together under Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme. Climate change is one of the most important issues facing the world today. In 2009, this Parliament voted unanimously to pass the Climate Change Scotland Act, and we have been working together since then to reduce emissions and to meet the very challenging targets set by the Act. And we're making good progress. We have already massively reduced emissions in Scotland, down 45.8% since 1990. This progress is reflected in the residential sector, where the share of homes with the top three energy efficiency EPC band C or better has increased by 74% since 2010. Since 2009, we have allocated over £650 million to domestic energy efficiency, and set out in the programme for government, we will make available £500 million over the next 4 years to tackle fuel poverty and improve energy efficiency. And as we go forward, Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme, or SEEP for short, will be the cornerstone of our approach to reducing emissions in the residential sector. Once fully operational, it will be a programme of sticks and carrots, bringing together grants and loans with advice and information backed up by standards and regulation that help to create demand and drive improvement. The programme is being developed, and we are consulting on policy options until the 30th of March. In addition, last week on a visit to Dalmarnock, the First Minister announced that we are making available a further £11 million of funding for councils to make homes, public buildings and businesses more energy efficient. The second wave of SEEP pilot fund will help local authorities test new and innovative energy savings approaches, And together, the consultation and those pilots will inform our long-term approach to delivery of SEEP, which will commence from 2018. I welcome this committee's scrutiny of the draft climate change plan, and I look forward to your questions today. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. I will move for an opening question to Graeme Simpson.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks, Minister, for attending. We've had a number of submissions, and we heard from witnesses last week around the perceived, well, not even perceived, lack of actual policy in the climate change plan. The plan has emissions reducing at twice the current rate over the next 4 years, but you don't seem to have any new policy or money to deliver that, which doesn't seem to me to stack up. So are you going to be introducing new policy or funding, or are existing policies just going to make do?
Well, as I said in my opening remarks, we're currently looking at these situations. And beyond that, you know, we're about to embark in very short course next month on consultation and how we deal with energy efficiency in the private rented sector. And that will also outline what we are going to do in terms of owner-occupied properties. For real transformation in this, we need to integrate tools such as the use of new incentives, standards and regulation. And of course, probably the most important thing is behavioural change. Supporting that with advice and information services and underpinned by strong supply chains with the right skills. So the cornerstone of what we are about to embark on to decarbonise Scotland's building stock is Scotland's energy efficiency programme. And we've set out the strategic vision for SEEP for 2050, that Scotland's buildings are near zero carbon by that date. And we want to ensure that this is dealt with and achieved in a way that is socially and economically sustainable, and adopted the challenging policy objectives that we've set out in the climate change plans. We recognise without any doubt that these are challenging targets, and we've been very clear that we do not have a preferred option at this stage, and the approach will likely vary across elements of the programme. We're therefore now asking stakeholders what is the best way to deliver the vision and the objectives of all of this. And while we develop SEEP, our existing programmes continue to deliver measures on the ground, helping folks make their homes warmer and cheaper to heat.
Right. Okay, so that kind of backs up what I was saying, that the document is called a plan, but it's not really a plan, it's a vision. A plan would be backed up by specific actions that would get to the targets that you've set. I mean, you know, wanting buildings to be near zero carbon, but you haven't actually said how you think that would be achieved.
Convener, I would reiterate the fact that we already have a number of things going on in the ground in terms of energy efficiency right across Scotland. And I would encourage the committee to go out and see some of the work that's being done on the ground, whether that be the delivery of HEAPS programmes at a local level, or looking at the work that Warm Homes Scotland is undertaking right across the country. I think one of the key things in all of this is that it would be a mistake rushing to one solution or a limited amount of solutions at this point in time to deal with this plan over the piece. Because we can see technologies changing as we progress. So what we are doing, what we are embarking on, I think, is extremely pragmatic. We will continue on dealing with the energy efficiency programmes that we already have, which have already seen a huge amount of interventions in homes right across Scotland. We intend to ensure that the rollout of energy efficiency as a whole, which has largely been concentrated in the social sector with some interventions in housing, private housing. We want to make sure that we get the private rented sector scenario right, and that's why we're about to engage in that consultation and then move into owner occupiers. But I think it would be very wrong of us to outlay a complete plan of every single action that is likely to be taken between now and a couple of decades away, because we are seeing those changes in technologies taking place. If we were to rush in to one technology change, that may actually be the very, very wrong thing to do. So, as I say, I think we're being pragmatic and logical in applying common sense to our approach. And, of course, convener, what we want to do is to ensure that we consult with all stakeholders to make this ambitious plan its targets a reality.
Is that okay for now, Mr. Simpson?
Absolutely, of course. There are other specific areas that we'll delve into.
Okay, we're going to look at some of that. Can I reassure the minister the committee's been out and about across the country looking at various initiatives on the ground? I myself was at Coop Housing in Glasgow looking at a biofuel community heating solution there, and one of the comments they made, well, I was asking them about how what the life time span was of it, and I think they said 15 years or so, and I pointed out to them, is that the same as like the rental income paying to sustain that, about replacing it in 15 years time? And they made the point, well, we have no idea what the technology is going to look like in 15 years time, so we have to be flexible in our approach to what we're going to do going forward. I thought that was quite a good example to illustrate of the committee. It might be an opportune, we're over tight for time today, but do you want to take a couple of minutes just to put on the record that visit, Mr.
Simpson? Very briefly, myself and Andy Wightman went on a visit to AIR, and we saw one of the area-based schemes where they're basically applying insulation to the outside of buildings. And I hadn't actually realised, it was very informative, but I hadn't actually realised how many buildings in Scotland require that kind of treatment. I think it's about 500,000. It's a massive number. So it was a good thing to see, and I think it's area-based schemes certainly are the way forward.
We'll certainly come on to the details of that.
Convener, if I can just come back.
Can we just leave that hanging, yeah, though? Because what I wanted to do is to reassure you when you mentioned that the committee should go out and about and see what was happening in the country, just to reassure we are actually doing that, Minister. We'll move to our next question. Ruth McGuire, thanks.
Convener, good morning, Minister. In their written submission to the committee, Food for Life Scotland highlighted the role that local government procurement can play in supporting, they were specifically talking about low carbon food systems. I'd just be keen to hear to what extent the Scottish Government expect the public sector to maximise these opportunities to reduce climate emissions as part of their own procurement.
Convener, I think I'm probably going to hark back a little bit to my own time in local government, where Aberdeen City and Shire established a joint procurement unit, and I think there was a great fear from many folks then that the emphasis would be on buying the cheapest possible product from wherever that may be, but a real bit of common sense came into play there, and I think local suppliers are key. I think that many local authorities, including in Ayrshire, if I remember rightly, are very careful in terms of procurement of the likes of food from local sources. So, while it's not for me to dictate, I think it would be wise for every local authority to look very carefully at where they are sourcing these kind of products from. Beyond that, in terms of some of the policy that government has put forward in recent times, the committee will be very well aware about the emphasis that was put in allotments in the Community Empowerment Bill, which took up an entire section of that bill. And there was probably more debate about some aspects of that than many other parts of the bill. And the conversations that were then had were not only about that, but about food sourcing from local sources in general. And I think that that is a really good thing. I would certainly encourage local authorities to look at the best practice that is happening out there in certain places around about these procurements. And certainly I would do everything that I possibly can to facilitate and export the information about that best practice.
Okay, thanks. That's me for now.
Can I just check, Minister, obviously you can't compel local authorities to do it, but is there procurement guidance that is specific to making sure that if they follow that closely, they will actually not be compelled to the best practice, but they will seek to follow the guidance so the output will be, there will be best practice anyway? Is there specific guidance in relation to that?
In terms of the energy efficiency aspect of this, government launched the energy efficiency, the non-domestic energy efficiency framework in March 2016. And that framework has been designed to support public and third sector organisations procure the likes of the retrofit work that Mr Simpson and Mr Wightman have seen in air. There's the economies of scale and the standardised approach offered by that pan public sector framework is it's attractive to both the public sector and the private sector and offers better solutions and better value for money. One of the things which I've seen myself on the ground in terms of procurement, in terms of energy efficiency, is that in some places, at the initial stages, some local authorities found it very, very difficult to find contractors, full stop. I'll give you the example. Orkney had great difficulty in bringing folk in to deal with their external cladding situation. That government's been pretty flexible about this as well, because you know, the normal situation would have been if you don't spend the money, it'll get clawed back. But we allowed them, recognising the circumstances, to keep the money that was available to them. They have eventually managed to procure and, of course, are building up local skills there to continue that project. So I think, you know, I think we've got that framework there. We've also got to allow a level of flexibility and understand that, you know, while it may be easy to get workers and contractors to do certain things in certain parts of the country, that's not so easy in others. But there are huge opportunities in terms of some of this, because it is offering up the ability of skills to occur in places where that's not happened before.
That would be helpful. It would be probably helpful for the committee. It's not a question, Minister. If you could maybe write to us and give us information how you, because you said you've got a desire to see best practice, how you promote information exchange between local authorities in relation to that best practice, and sure, how guide, what elements guidance plays within that, or the ability to improve or enhance guidance. That would be quite helpful for the committee, I think. Okay, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. There have been some concerns expressed about the lack of engagement with communities during the development of the draft plan. And I'd like to ask what the Scottish Government are going to develop as the plan becomes the finalised plan as to how you're going to see how you can further engage with communities.
I wonder, Convener, I'm not trying to be awkward here in any way, can Mr Stewart give us examples of where he feels that engagement has not been at its best?
Well, I've been, like others in the committee, we've gone out to visit and see, and there's certainly projects taking place on the ground that we can all visit and we can see what happens. But I think when we're looking at specific locations across Scotland and some organisations that one would have maybe expected to be part of the process, that haven't maybe engaged as much. And there is a feeling that there has been a lack, Minister, about that. And we have an opportunity now before the draft becomes the final plan for to go back and engage with some of these organisations that we maybe would have thought. We got some of that evidence when we had individuals here that felt that too. So there's a feeling that there hasn't been enough done so far, and that needs to be developed as we go forward.
Mr Stewart, might be helpful. In the briefing prepared by Spicen for this particular evening session, the Scottish Community Alliance highlighted their concerns in their written submission to this committee at the limited community engagement in developing the plan. It said today, active engagement with communities on this agenda has been limited. We see this as a missed opportunity to capture the energy, enthusiasm, ingenuity that is inherent in all of the places we live. That's only one submission, of course, Minister, but that was the example given. Sorry, Mr Stewart.
Well, I'm very keen, Convener, as I am in all of the areas that I'm responsible for, and the government as a whole is always keen to consult as much as possible and hear what communities and stakeholders have to say. I said earlier on, you know, one of the things that we're going to have to do is to ensure that there's massive behavioural change out there. And in order to facilitate that, we're going to have as much communication as possible with everyone around about this extremely important agenda. Now, you know, I'll take what those folks have said, and we'll have a look at that. But you know, there are a number of things which are going on at this moment in time, even down to household levels. You know, where we are funding Home Energy Scotland, who, of course, provide the advice and support to households, including how energy saving about their energy saving behaviours. Now, I've gone out a fair bit to look at what's going on in the ground, and to hear what is being said by folks, and I think that is helping. I think we all have a job to do. In terms of that behavioural change, but they and others, including a pilot we're running with EST, which is trying to find new ways of embedding that behavioural change, is extremely important. I will take on board what Mr Stewart has said, and I will have a look at what communication is going on. And how we are dealing with that. I think one of the key things, Convener, in all of this always is it's the job for all of us in this place and beyond to try and persuade folk to respond to consultations. I know that sometimes they're not the easiest documents to deal with. But I have to say that in terms of the online consultation that we've been carrying out in recent years in various subjects, they're quite easy to navigate. We probably should do more to say to folk, you don't have to answer every question. And, you know, if there's something that is not there, you can have your say. We have had stakeholder events which were held before Christmas on the draft plan and on SEEP 2. I'll have a look and see who attended those and what we can maybe do to encourage more people to become involved, because it's absolutely vital that we get as many folk as possible, that all of the folk out there, in fact, on this agenda, so that we can move forward with this ambitious plan and get that behavioural change that we need.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. Thank you, Minister. We'll get a supplementary from Elaine Smith, and just to let Andy Whiteman know, we'll be taking him next for a question. Okay.
Thank you, Convener. And welcome along, Minister, this morning. You mentioned individual actions. We had a submission from the Smart Energy GB about smart meters. So I just wonder if this might be an appropriate point for you to say something about smart meters. But my further question was, I recall reading... Is that someone's question?
No, it's not. Please continue, Deputy Convener.
I thought I'd stolen someone's question there. But also on boilers, Minister, I thought I'd maybe read somewhere about a window of opportunity or a seven-year window for changing boilers, but I wondered about that and whether that means households have to replace boilers, what the incentives to do that. I know these are specific, but they're about the individual actions that you mentioned when okay. you were responding on communities.
I'm probably going to take Mr. Garland in at this point and on smart meters, if you don't mind, Convener.
Okay, Mr. Garland, yes, of course.
I'll see what I can do on that. Certainly on the smart meter rollout, there is definitely an opportunity there to kind of look at the fact that there's going to be interventions, people going to everyone's home, coming in and kind of the opportunity to kind of link that to work we're doing on energy efficiency and the wider kind of climate change approach. And that's something we're looking at in terms of what that opportunity is. The energy companies are dealing with that in kind of different rates themselves. But it is something that government are aware of. And Mr. Wheelhouse is something that he has looked into and has discussed with energy companies. I don't have specific details in terms of what's planned on that, but it's something that's on our agenda. In terms of the seven-year window for boilers, I'm not so sure on that one, I'm afraid.
Maybe I'll deal with that. I think one of the things that we've got to recognise is that our future energy mix is likely to be different from what we're familiar with today. And working with partners, we'll consider what the most appropriate solution is, including district heating, electric heat pumps, biomass, or the repurposing of the gas network to supply biogas or hydrogen. And we'll put forward much more detailed proposals on how we'll realise significant heat decarbonisation in a subsequent climate change plan. Now, Ms. Smith mentioned the seven-year window she described it as. As I say, we're continuing to develop delivery mechanisms. For example, I think the most recent call on SEEP delivery programme pilot calls for project will help us deliver programme pilots for these kind of options. These include projects which are taking an area-based approach to renewable heat technologies in off-gas grid areas. And as part of the SEEP programme development, we're going to carry out a high-level policy scoping consultation on district heating regulation and a potential duty on local authorities to develop local heat and energy efficiency strategies. And that will give us a solid foundation from which to decarbonise the heat supply of our buildings in the futures. I think it's worth remembering that around half of non-domestic buildings are already supplied using electricity. And that means that there will be little or no change there. However, you know, like every other procurement, in your own home or wherever it may be, you've got to look at the lifetime costs of what you're embarking on. And I think that's one of the things that the convener himself picked up on in terms of his visit, because during the course of this, there may be those technology advances, as these folks have rightly pointed out. I hope that's helpful to Ms. Smith.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Andy Wightman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister, for coming. Just a two or three questions on domestic heat. Policy outcome one in the climate change plan envisages improvements to the fabric of Scotland's domestic buildings, resulting in a 6% reduction in their heat demand by 2032. I've been seeking to understand this figure a little bit better to know whether the 6% is a reduction on the aggregate demand now or a 6% reduction on the aggregate forecast demand in 2032 or a reduction in the per unit, per square foot, square metre residential unit heat demand. Can you help me?
There's some very complex questions there from Mr. Wightman that I would expect. And I understand that he asked some similar questions at the Economy Committee the other day. The scenario on demand, and I'm looking to Mr. Garland as I say this, just to get this absolutely right, it's demand based on 2030. Am I correct in saying that, Mr. Garland?
It's based on where we expect demand to be 2032. But I think you'd also had asked questions in terms of what that position will be in 2032. And we've undertaken to write to you following kind of written questions from the Economy Committee. And we'd also obviously would share that with this committee as well.
I have a list of questions that you asked at the Economy Committee, Mr. Wightman, and I understand that officials who were there agreed to write to that committee with more detailed responses to Mr. Wightman. Convener, if it's okay with you, I will ask that this committee also gets those detailed responses so that you have the same information as the Economy Committee around about some of these areas of interest to Mr. Wightman and others.
That would be very helpful. Of course, I can't preclude these. Nobody said in agreement, Minister. I can't preclude Mr. Wightman from wanting to re-ask those questions.
I wouldn't expect you.
If he so chooses, are you content with that, Mr. Wightman?
Yes, I mean, we're short of time and I intend to move on. So thank you very much for that. We've heard evidence from organisations like the Assisting Homes Alliance who say that, quote, there's a credibility gap in the near term in terms of the goal of decarbonising and increasing energy efficiency of domestic buildings. And that one of the reasons for that credibility gap is the lack of very, very specific, clearly targeted policies with numbers attached about carbon, with timescales and with budgets. And I hear what you said earlier about maintaining flexibility, and that's perfectly reasonable. But one of the most straightforward ways of building in targets would be to adopt a target of getting the vast majority of homes to EPC band C by 2025. That'd be a very, very specific, very time-limited standard. Are you open to reflecting that in the final plan?
Convener, I've been looking with interest at some of the things that have been said by stakeholders, including the Existing Homes Alliance. And Elizabeth Layton said the ambitious targets for the residential sector and energy efficiency and renewable heat are welcome. And she talks of ramping up what we're doing. I think one of the key things for me in all of this, and I go back to my point from earlier about let's look at what solutions are going to be available. Obviously, there are things which we are going to do anyway in terms of the insulation work, the kind of work that Mr. Simpson and yourself, Mr. Wightman, seen in air. And we will continue in that regard. In terms of the EPC Band C scenario, I've already said that we have an ambitious programme that is going to help transform the built environment. It'll cut emissions as well as it as making it easier and cheaper to heat. We'll see a reduction in emissions from the residential sector by 75% on 2014 levels. We also at the same time have to ensure that poor housing is no longer a cause of fuel poverty. But on EPC Ban C, a one-size-fits-all target may not be appropriate for something as diverse as our housing stock. And we're seeking views on target setting in consultation on SEEP, which, as I've already said, is open until the 30th of May. I think, you know, in some regards, we do have to be completely and utterly realistic about some of these things. And some of this is not as simple as we may think. And I was struck by that lesson in a visit to, again, it was Orkney, where they were talking about some of their housing stock. And I'd say they've had a slow start in some regards, but have done very well. But they were quite honest about some of the housing stock that was in the council's control, where they said that it would be impossible to ever get some of that property up to bands EPC band C. They were talking about housing that they had in their stock from the Napoleonic era, which, you know, the interventions that you would have to take would probably negate anything at all, not negate anything at all. So I think we have to be realistic about generalising about that particular rating target. We will look at what comes back in the consultation, but we have got to be aware that out there are many buildings where there are anomalies. And to say that we should aim for a uniform EPC band C is probably unrealistic.
Okay, thank you. I understand that. I don't think anyone's arguing for absolutely every single building. We have buildings that go back to predate the Napoleonic Wars. It's a question of the vast majority, but that's helpful. Finally, just a question on the owner-occupied housing and private rented housing. You indicated earlier you will be consulting on the private rented housing. You were not as clear as to precisely what the nature of the consultation on the owner-occupied sector would be. And I note, for example, obviously the regulation of the private rented and owner-occupied sector has been long promised. The powers are in the Climate Change Act in 2009. It featured as a potential enabling measure in RPP1, it was included as a concrete proposal in RPP2. It was developed with stakeholders to detailed pre-consultation through the REAPS working group in the last parliament. And I'm concerned that given all of that work, given where we are and how ready we are to do that, that the forthcoming consultation will just be kicking this can further down the road.
The consultation on the private rented sector will be published next month. We'll give a timescale at that point about owner-occupiers too. You know, some of this could have happened before, but due to the UK government changes to the funding landscape in 2015, Scottish ministers reluctantly took the decision to postpone that consultation on minimal standards in 2015 because the funding situation was so uncertain at that point. But we will publish the private rented sector consultation next month, and we will give at that point timescales about owner-occupiers. So that's not kicking things into the long grass. That's actually dealing with us next month.
Yes, next month you will produce a consultation on the private rented sector. Are you saying that in that document you will have a timescale for future consultation on the owner-occupied sector?
We will give timescales of what we intend to do in owner-occupier situations at the same time.
I look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wightman. I know there was a couple of supplementaries tied in that a couple of committee members had. I'll take Elaine Smith first, then I'll take Graham Simpson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just specifically on further to the question that Andy Wightman asked, Minister, could you tell us about the policies that are going to result in the doubling of insulation measures in 2018? What would those specific policies be? And also, I was frantically looking through my papers there, but we had some evidence to suggest that the materials used for insulation might not be that environmentally friendly, and I don't know if you or your officials have any comment on that.
Let me take Mr. Garland in and about the materials, because I'm not exactly sure about that, to be honest, Ms. Smith.
It's not something I've heard directly either, so we're very pleased to get further information on that, and we can respond to you directly.
Okay. And also the targets for 2018? The specific doubling of insulation measures?
We're currently delivering over 80,000 measures per annum. The plan itself sets out from 2018 90,000 measures which will need to be installed per annum. And those measures modelled were limited to loft and wall and cavity and solid insulation. However, in reality, we deliver a much broader set of measures, including, for example, heating systems and controls, floor insulation, and also glazing in certain parts. Currently, across the schemes, in the region of about 80 to 90,000 are delivered per annum. And about half of these are wall and loft insulation. So it's true to say that the efforts and loft and wall insulation will need to double under the plan. Of course, in terms of a lot of these interventions that have taken place, we've seen a huge amount in the public sector and not so much in the private rented or owner or occupier sector, so that's where we will have to move on. SEEP, of course, will be the delivery mechanism for all of our efforts in terms of energy efficiency. And I think that while it's no small undertaking, you know, we have the ability to make these situations become reality. And we will work up all that needs to be done through the SEEP programme, which we are putting in place. And again, and I can't advertise this enough, Convener, that consultation is open until the end of May, and we're keen to hear from all stakeholders about what they think of the proposals therein.
Do you want to add to that?
No, that's fine.
Okay, Graham Simpson.
Thank you. You mentioned EPCs earlier on. We heard some evidence last week that the actual whole system of EPCs is flawed. They're not particularly accurate. Two people assessing a property can come up with varying results. I've certainly heard that that the system discriminates against homeowners in the off-gas rural areas. So given that, do you have any plans to reform the EPC system?
I am going to take Mr. Garland in initially there, Convener, if you don't mind, please.
There's a process for looking at what are the issues that are raised in terms of kind of use of EPCs and certainly the underlying assessment protocols, SAP, that's used for that. And that's something that the Scottish Government has been looking at over a number of years and collating issues such as those you raised there. And we have a process in which we engage with the UK Government to ensure that those issues are kind of picked up. It's very much part of the issues we're looking at within the development of SEEP is the making sure that we have assessment processes that are fit for purpose. So we are looking at kind of taking into account issues that may be with our assessment processes and building that into the programme. It will be one of the things that is raised in the consultations that we'll be bringing out as well on regulation, and we'll look at that issue.
Convener, if I can come in now, you know, assessment methodologies are part of the consultation on SEEP. And, you know, as I go out and about, you hear different opinions about whether things are good or bad, or whether assessments are right or not. You know, I think I would encourage folk to respond to the consultation. I also feed back to officials the things that I hear when I'm out and about. I was in Shetland on Monday, and one of the construction firms there talked in some depth about SAP, and felt that there was some failings, which, you know, when I hear these things, where they give folks give me examples of where they think that things are not quite right, or maybe not quite right for their particular area, for various reasons, including geography and access to grid, then I always feed that back in. But for those kind of situations, you know, I've been saying to folk, feed into this consultation, and then, you know, the more folk who bring up the anomalies that often exist, the easier it is to deal with some of those anomalies.
Right in thinking that we could have a Scottish system of EPCs. It doesn't have to be UK-wide, does it?
I think a lot of it not based on European.
It's to do with compliance with the European directive. In terms of at the moment we work on a UK basis. In terms of whether or not they should or shouldn't be a Scottish version, that's something we would need to take a view on. We don't have a view on that at the moment in terms of whether or not there should be one. It's an understood process in terms of assessing what a house is or a building's performance is, but it's certainly one that's understood to have flaws, and we are looking at how to bring that forward in terms of kind of improving it.
Okay. Well, I mean, given that we all seem to accept it's got flaws, maybe it is worth considering having a Scottish solution to something that we know is not working.
Convener, I wouldn't go as far as to say that it's not working. I am not averse to looking at change where change is required. But I think that no matter what, if you were to put in another universal system, there are likely to be some anomalies because of particular circumstance, I would say. Obviously, as I've said, wherever I hear of any difficulties in this regard, and they're pretty few, it has to be said, I feed that in to officials. But I think it would be very wrong of us to say that the system is flawed. Paul, there may be some anomalies. I don't think you could go as far as to say that the system is completely flawed.
Any more questions? Thank you very much. Kenneth Gibson.
I'm glad to see that, you know, that Graham supports independence for EPCs. It's a start. You know?
Devolution.
Yeah, I thought you would say that. Minister, good afternoon. in its submission, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations has said, and I quote, that funding for low-carbon heating should be concentrated in off-gas areas with a target to have renewable and low-carbon heating in all off-gas areas by 2025. Obviously, my own constituency, I've got two islands, Cumbria and Arran, and both of those are off-gas areas. I'm just wondering what the Scottish Government proposes to do in terms of addressing that aim.
David Stewart of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, I think, was the one that that said that. And, you know, I'm very aware of the difficulties that are faced currently in off-gas areas. And in particular, take cognizance that in some places that are off-gas island communities, the cost of electricity is much higher. Obviously, one of the things which we are very keen to see is the use of other technologies to ensure that we do our very best. In Shetland on Monday, in Orkney, I'm trying to think where else I've seen them. You know, the use of low carbon heat options using heat pumps in particular is quite something. I visited a new scheme by the Yatland Housing Association at the old Met Office site just outside Lerwick on Monday, and I was asking about the heat pumps that they were using, I think that in terms of the technology that is being used there, the cost of that technology now compared to what it is, and the outcome for homeowners, it's the right way to go. And I think that these technologies will improve as we go on. So in terms of these off-gas, off-grid areas, you know, that is the way forward, I would say. Unless, of course, there is a mass, again, if we look at Lerwick, they've got the district heating scheme there, which works obviously very well for large parts of Lerwick, but not those folks outside. So I think, you know, there's huge opportunities now for folks who are off-grid that did not exist before. And we have got to recognise that, and we will build on that in terms of the SEEP framework.
Thank you. I mean, some of the fuel that's used on our islands at the moment include oil-based solutions, so obviously we want to try and get away from those. And I mean, you obviously talked about innovative technologies and the opportunities that are available, but I mean, it sounds a bit, frankly, piecemeal. Is there no strategy to deliver comprehensively in these communities, as the SFHA are suggesting, could be done by 2025, which is 8 years away, to try and harness these and produce, because obviously you get economies of scale if it's been done on a more strategic level rather than hoping that, you know, some individuals will and some individuals won't, you know, because we could find ourselves, you know, a decade from now and it's still a major issue in some of these communities.
I think one of the key things in all of this, convener, is getting all of our partners to come on board in helping deliver. Because the experts in what goes on in island and very rural communities are the locals themselves and the local councils. And in terms of working out plans to deliver, I would expect local authorities like North Ayrshire, and your own one, to help come up with innovative plans to help deliver these solutions for people. Now, obviously, the seat pilots, which we've announced, and I talked about the second pilot that the First Minister announced last week in Dalmarnock, you know, all of that is being, most of that, sorry, not all of it, vast bulk of that is being led by local authorities. It is them that are receiving the cash, and it is them that are driving forward projects. Now, you know, I would be very, very keen to see all authorities bidding for a share of this, with the right schemes, of course. And I see no reason why the likes of North Ayrshire should not put forward some kind of innovative plan for the likes of the Cumbrae's.
Thank you. That's good.
Mr. Wightman, I think you were going to explore some more questions around this policy outcome theme before we moved on to planning. I don't know if you want to do that now. Okay, well, I've got one more that I would like to add. There was a concern that low-carbon technologies can be expensive to run and maintain, and therefore there can be a relationship between low-carbon technologies and fuel poverty, unless we got other measures such as energy efficiency measures right within properties as well. I think it was the SFHA that raised some concerns in relation to that and evidence. I would be interested in any reflections you have on that, Minister.
Well, I think if I just go back to what I said in response to Mr. Gibson there, you know, new technologies are often expensive to start with, but costs do go down. And there is the volume aspect of it too. Now, as we move on, in terms of our ambitions to decarbonise even more, we're going to have to use more of these new technologies. And if you look at lifetime costs of a technology, what I would ask folk at this moment, is it worth your while putting in something new in terms of the old old technology, which might be inexpensive at this moment in time, but what is the lifetime cost of that going to be compared to putting in a new piece of kit, which, you know, will last that much longer in terms of the changes that we will see. You know, the plan itself is pretty good in the fact that, you know, a lot of the new technologies that we hope that will come into play, and there may be even different technologies by the time we get to that point, you know, we'll see them advance as we go on. I mean, there are things which we are not doing here in the UK at the moment, which are being done elsewhere, where there is a level of testing here which is only just starting, like the like hydrogen technology, for example, where I don't think there's been a move fast enough, and the UK government, of course, controls the gas networks, and there's H21 project in Leeds, which has not moved very far at all, whereas other places, you know, are looking at putting biogas and hydrogen into their gas networks. We are behind in that, and we don't have the power here to deal with that ourselves, and are reliant on others to bring some of that forward, and we will continue to encourage that. But, you know, that hydrogen technology, that biogas use, is not likely to happen in the first phase of this plan, and that's why, you know, we have laid out the plan in the way that we have. the initial point is that you made is cost now compared.
Was a very specific one, which I don't know if you've actually addressed, which was Scottish Federation of Housing Associations have said that the plan could be strengthened because of the expense of low-carbon technologies in relation to improving both energy efficiency and reducing fuel poverty. And the SFA had some... SFA, that's twice that, I think that's been said. The SFHA have said perhaps the plan could be strengthened in that area. Don't expect you to see how it should be strengthened just now, Minister, but is that something you'd reflect on? Because we have to report in relation to this plan.
I hope the Scottish Football Association will be as interested in the decarbonisation as well as everyone else. I hope everyone is. Let me put it quite simply. The reason why we're focusing on energy efficiency in the early years of the plan is because, you know, there may be that situation where folk are uncomfortable about the technologies and all of the rest, which, you know, we can deal with at a later date. Dealing with the energy efficiency aspect of it also means that properties are then ready to be converted to low carbon heat. So as well as helping reduce bills now, it also helps mitigate any energy price rises in the future. It's really important, I think, that in terms of the decarbonisation of our built environment, that we do so in a way that is socially and economically sustainable. And obviously, convener, as you know, I've got a responsibility for fuel poverty too. So all of this has to interlink. Absolutely right. So that we can do our very best for people and ensure that they can live in warm homes in a good environment. As well as a
Minister, I would want to leave time for the planning section, and Mr. White wants to come in. But that last section said there was helpful because if the SFHA have said perhaps the plan could be strengthened in relation to that link that you've just put on record yourself between getting it right between energy efficiency measures and tackling fuel poverty, if we can get something in relation to that at a later date, that would be quite helpful because we have to respond to all the evidence we receive, and I think you were hinting towards it there.
I am more than willing, after the consultation on CEPA is finished with, and after the analysis is done, I'm more than willing to come back to the committee, because obviously the consultation is going to have to take cognizance of stakeholder views. Other views that come in. So, you know, I think the key thing in all of this, and I'm parroting again, is to get as many views in the consultation so that we can create the best possible plan, the best possible means of delivering the aims of that plan.
Thank you very much, Minister. We'll move on to the next section now. Mr. Wightman.
Thank you, Conveners. To move on to planning, the draft climate change plan just has one page on the planning system. It opens by saying, and I quote, ensuring the planning system supports decarbonisation is another essential element of the Scottish Government's approach to meeting the statutory climate change targets. And yet it doesn't say anything about, you know, how the planning system could do that. At the moment, the objectives for decarbonisation and mitigating climate change are contained in the National Planning Framework. Are you, you know, open to the prospect of, in the forthcoming planning bill, embedding the need to decarbonise and move to low-carbon society as a principal purpose of planning, given the role that planning plays in terms of designing places and standards and transport modes across Scotland?
Convener, planning already has an important role to play, I think, in reducing emissions and adapting to future climate change. First of all, we've got to locate development in the right place to provide the opportunities for folk to make sustainable choices and to improve their quality of life. We've got to, and we are, helping aid the transition to a low-carbon economy, including supporting diversification of energy infrastructure. And before I came in here this morning, I was reading a tweet about the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy, Keith Brown, addressing a conference this morning where he was talking about cities taking the lead in decarbonisation. And planning also, you know, has to set the environmental limits. And also, we've got to ensure that transport and digital infrastructure are delivered by the planning system. Planning, of course, largely focuses on new developments and change of use and strategic plans. And it doesn't concentrate on existing buildings. And a lot of the work that we have to undertake in delivering here is on what currently exists. As Mr. Wightman well knows, we published our planning consultation earlier on this year, which goes on till April 4th. And I'm very keen to show that planning can guide sustainable communities and to support the development of low carbon infrastructure. Of course, the document itself also confirms that the National Planning Framework should continue to bring together Scottish Government policies, including on climate change. But, you know, I understand where Mr. Wightman's coming from in terms of planning as a tool to achieve a number of these goals, and I don't disagree. I think that it has a great part to play. But I do think that a huge amount of what we have to achieve is changing existing buildings and places to get to the place that we need to be in terms of decarbonisation.
Thank you. I can leave it at that. That's helpful. And obviously, this conversation on planning has some way to run. Just one. Just final
supplementary, is it on planning?
It's on planning, but so if Andy Wightman's staying on planning, I could ask after that.
Yes, a brief further question on planning. This is a very sort of particular one, Minister. The planning white paper proposes repealing Section 72 of the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009, which is about local government powers regarding low-carbon projects, zero-carbon projects in local development plans. And yet the Scottish Government's sixth annual report on the operation of Section 72 of the Climate Change Scotland Act 29, which was published in March 2016, concludes that the Scottish Government's concluded that the legislation should remain in force. What's your view?
Convener, Mr. Wightman is right. We want to remove planning procedures that don't add value. The climate change plan is clear that there's a further role for reducing building-based emissions. And in significant part, this is around energy use for space heating. As currently drafted, Section 72-3F has the potential to work against the delivery of community network-based heating schemes, as the legislation itself promotes individual-based building-based technologies. Obviously, we would welcome comments on these proposals by the 4th of April. You know, I'm sure that Mr. Wightman and others would want to remove impediments that could lead to community-based or network-based heating schemes. If the committee wants further detail on that, I'm more than willing to write.
Okay, thank you. It was interesting that on the 22nd of March, you know, the government thought the legislation should remain in force, and then it's changed. I'm very open to amending legislation, but very concerned that whatever legislation we've already got to give encouragement and powers to local government to deliver low and zero carbon is not in any way diluted. Certainly, if it's getting in the way, that's one thing. I'm content to leave it there.
I'll write to Mr. Wightman and the committee in some more depth on it, convener. Obviously, we want to see zero carbon generating technology to be the best that it can be, and there is a situation here where I think that maybe this section is not quite right, but we'll provide you with more detail, including around about the building standards aspects of this.
Okay, thank you very much. Elaine Smith, final question.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to pick up two of the submissions we had. We had a lot of submissions, we've had a lot of interest. But in two of the submissions and on planning, the first one is the RSPB Scotland, who say at the start of their submission that they consider planning to be central to the delivery of the climate change plan. And further on, they point out that the role of planning in supporting modal shift in travel from private car to public and active travel is not covered in the draft climate change plan. And they say, indeed, there's very little on managing demand for travel or promoting sustainable modes. And they then go on to talk about local authorities and the way they could maybe use their support for buses and active travel routes. So that's one submission. The second submission was from Sustaining Dunbar. And they actually point out that they feel that people in their experience would be happy to make many of the lifestyle changes required to reduce their household carbon footprint, but they think that people face barriers and perverse incentives, is the words that they use, and they feel that one of those perverse incentives would be flights being cheaper than trains and mixed messages from the Scottish Government on sustainable economic growth. So I think I just wanted to, under the planning issue, to just put those two particular submissions to you to see if there's any comment going forward. And I appreciate that it is, you talk about the consultation, and it may be that this would be part of, you know, their views would be part of that.
Convener, I'm not going to get into too much depth on transport, which is not in my portfolio, but I will deal with the planning aspects of this, as Ms. Smith has asked. Scottish Planning Policy 2014 is clear that the planning system should apply a town centre first policy, as the committee is probably well aware. And should take cognizance of this when planning for uses which attract significant numbers of people. It also suggests that a mix of uses should be encouraged in town centres to support their vibrancy, vitality and viability. That's not the easiest thing to say. Maybe we should have rethought that out when we wrote that into planning policy. And the MPF3, of course, sets out a strategy which reinforces the role of key settlements and towns in more rural areas. And it's clear that development plans should promote opportunities for travel by more sustainable modes. And there's actually an order of priority within that policy, which is walking, cycling, public transport, cars. So that's the hierarchy of all of that, which is actually laid out in the policy itself. The SPP is also clear that planning permission should not be granted for significant travel generating uses at locations which would increase reliance on the private car, and where direct links to local facilities via walking and cycling networks are not available or cannot be made available. And then it goes into great depth about travel to local facilities, and even greater depth about transport assessments. So this is already built in terms of planning policy. I can't comment on the individual submissions that you've had, particularly from Sustainable Dunbar, because I haven't seen them. But as I've outlined there, within Scottish planning policy itself, there is a real emphasis on transport, and I would hope that planning authorities would be taking cognizance of all of this in terms of the development of their local plans and strategies.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister, for that. Thank you, Elaine. Time is upon us, and Minister, if there's any final comments you want to make before we move into private
session? I'm fine, thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Just put on the record finally that this committee has to finalise a report on this by the 8th of March. So if there is any additional information you want to feed in, Minister, you or your team ahead of us finalising a report, that's the timescale we're working towards. But thank you very much, Minister, and your officials for coming along today. It's been very helpful, and we now move into private session. Thank you.